So we have heard something about Duotech the program, some library stuff. What I want to do is to explore a bit what the consequences are for macro packages. So I'm actually creating Frank's next nightmares. So where does tech end, if you put it on the tech end, and where does Lua start, and vice versa, the other way around. Okay, first a few remarks. Well, you refer to the Alderberg meeting, and I think if we actually look back, we can safely say nothing happened, yeah? No real extensions were made to tech. So when we started the LuaTech project, one of the things that we decided is we will not provide solutions. We will just open up machinery, because everybody wants his own solutions, and it saves a lot of discussion. And I think there is some general agreement about what people would like to do, but I'm pretty sure that, let's say, a later spacing model is completely different from a context spacing model, and if we try to hard code all that kind of stuff into an engine, you keep coding and never reach a solution. As a consequence, it means that as we don't provide solution, that the macro writer or the writer of macro packages should provide a solution. They are the ones interfacing to Lua. For instance, what Hartmut showed, there is an image library, and each macro package can see how they hook it into their own stuff. And in the next couple of pictures, I will show what so far has been the consequence for context. And I will do that by stepwise going through the development of LuaTech. But the first ideas were just to add, well, it was, as I told before, I'm using an editor that has Lua as an extension language. And by playing with that, it would be nice to have the same thing in tech. And then Hartmut and I had a little bit of discussion, and then suddenly it was there, and play a bit, and that was basically a starting point. Just have some scripting engine in tech. And this is really the simple way of using Lua. Users can use Lua as a programming language and just leave everything tech untouched. And an example of usage is that what we have in our workflows is sometimes masks that needs to be entered. Very simple, and what we call calculator mass, the basic Texas Instrument calculator mass. You can have that kind of input stream just to convert it into something tech, get it typeset, but it has nothing to do basically with tech. You're just converting, and this is the kind simple kind of Lua usage that we were first thinking of. Well, the next stage is what would be handy if you can use Lua to do some of the calculations that in tech, yeah, get bloated. So access to registers was added. First, only dimensions and counters, and well, you couldn't do some. It's easier simply to have a loop and over a thousand thingies and calculate the average than assigning things to dimmen scratch with registers and things like that. So that was already a bit more techy, so to say. I think the first really big thing that was implemented or re-implemented in Lua tech was the whole I/O system. And there was actually a reason for that. It's the starting point of everything tech, is of course I/O. But another reason is that we have been hearing for maybe 10 years about extending capacity with things like reading from zip files, reading from web pages and whatever, and it never came. And this opened up the possibility to say, well, just kick out the existing stuff and replace it by your own stuff. So the first thing I did, it was my first real big Lua experience, is to rewrite Capacity in Lua. It's a scripting language, but which is actually faster than the original C thing, and also more flexible. So we can read from zip files, and we can read from FTP sites and whatever. I must admit that I seldom do it, but it can be done. In theory, you can say I have a complete tech distribution running from a zip file. A logical next step was to look at, well, since LuaTeX is UTF-8, see what are we going to do with all the input encodings. These are called regimes, input regimes in context. And well, if you read in your data using Lua and then pipe it back to TeX using callback, then it makes sense to re-implement this part, and all the code related to this kind of stuff was just kicked out of context and replaced by a couple of mapping tables that we hooked into the Lua code. So this was really the first time that you saw the traditional TeX part becoming smaller and Lua code becoming larger. Next big effort was something that, well, has been bothering me for quite a while. That's the traditional MetaPost conversion involves some nasty calculations if it comes down to pen transformed paths. That's not my one, is it? No, just kick it on. We'll see the both. The red button. Okay. And so there's quite some nasty calculation going on, and over time it evolved to something that was actually usable and reasonably fast. So that could be done better in Lua. And the nice thing at that point, the LPEG library came around, and really, even if you don't want to use LuaTeX, it is worth looking into LPEG, because this is really something, I think, maybe not revolutionary, but in a sense it is. And so it was a good exercise to do that kind of stuff also in Lua. It also was a little bit faster, not that much, but it was noticeable. This is one of the interesting things. If you think that LuaTeX will by replacing TeX code by Lua code, that you will get a faster thing, this is not true. Because at the same time, you often start doing more. It's a bit the same as if you take a modern engine, probably the same as true for CTeX. Well, the fonts are bigger to start with, yeah? So everything related to loading font, embedding font, everything. So you will enter with a slightly slower system anyway. At that time, we got the first access to the node list. I will not go into details about what node lists are. The nodes and tokens, this is typically the kind of things that you need to avoid at a conference. And it became possible to manipulate these things. For the moment, think of a node list as a linked list of thingies, and some of these thingies are characters, or basically glyphs. And if you can really touch them, if you can say, okay, I see, let's say, a small letter A, and I want it to be an uppercase, you can change it at that level. Now imagine that this kind of stuff happens at the TeX level. It, at some point, it doesn't matter what you implement. It always breaks at some point because users are kind of unpredictable. And if you can postpone that kind of stuff and do it later on, then you can implement rather robust solutions. So this was the first thing that we started adding stuff that was really operating at the internals. And okay, I can show you, this is not something that you have to do yourself. This is the same kind of thing that Markup Package writers will do for you. Really impact was when the open type font readers were added. Be warned, LuaTeX does not implement open type support. It provides a loader for OpenType fonts, and you have to implement OpenType support. Because today we have OpenType, and tomorrow you might have something else. So this is what I started with. We provide the means and not the solutions. It means that if you look in the context distribution, the Mark IV part of it, you will find a file of, I think, some 80 kilobytes of OpenType feature processing code. The nice thing is that because, well, it's an open system, you can still tweak and deal with all kinds of things. For me, it was a good way to explore open type fonts, and also to come to the conclusion that a lot of stuff in there is pretty undefined, undocumented, and well, messy. It's also fun because I like to do things with fonts. This is fun programming. Okay, then after OpenType fonts, you start thinking about, yeah, but we don't have that many OpenType fonts. We have a lot of Type 1 fonts. At least on my machine, there are lots of commercial Type 1 fonts. How to deal with them? And that was the moment when I realized that I could kick out TFMs. And I just started reading the AFM file, mapping the AFM file on the Unicode range, and just treating it as basically an open type form. That was when Type already mentioned the more effective font inclusion mechanism where taken care of. And in principle, you can use Type 1 fonts in their wide incarnation. They are not limited to 256 characters. As a result, I could kick out font encoding, which is a rather substantial part of, I think, any macro package. All kind of definitions, remappings, fallbacks, the whole crap is gone. The only thing that we still use TFM files for is Mars, and that's only because I'm still waiting for that guy on Mars to show up, and after that we will kick out that kind of stuff too. I'm already preparing for that. One of the things that you may wonder is, okay, so a lot of things are done in Lua. What is the impact on the runtime? I keep quite close track of how many time is spent by Lua doing things, and you really must imagine that we are talking about lots of things. If you are looping over the node list, let's say the considered for a moment the whole page, you're normally talking about some 4,000 characters plus a bunch of glue and other thingies. And if you look what I'm already doing, you're talking about hundreds of loops over these lists, which may concern hundreds of loops over individual nodes of those lists. And if you have complex fonts like Sapfino, you're talking about maybe thousands of loops over each character, looking forward and backward, because there is contextual lookup, and there may be hundreds of lookups per glyph that may have a potential match. So we are quickly talking about millions of many millions of operations on nodes in a scripting language, and it's really incredible how fast Lua is. We have optimized over time a lot of the interfacing to that kind of stuff, but it's surprisingly fast. And for me that's quite promising, because it means that there's a lot of room to where you can waste time. another nice thing is Hartmut showed already the virtual font thing. I imagine that you have this font and it doesn't have all the composed characters. One thing is that you can do is you can just build them. If you have the right data at hand, and one of the things in the context market for distribution is, I think by now, 2.5 megabyte file with specific data about glyphs and characters and things like that, mostly taken from Unicode plus a bit more, you can say, okay, I have a U and I have an umlaut, so I can combine the things into a U umlaut or whatever. This is really something that's new. Here we really start doing things that could not be done before. Yeah, well, you could do then, but no user was doing that on his disk, I think. This is really new stuff. A really nice feature is that, the best example of what we already have is fonts. If you have a font, Tef more or less remembers for each character what the current font is. And so this means that if you put something in a box and you unbox it, it's basically frozen. It knows what fonts are used for the characters in that box. Color, there was Martin's talk about these interfering WotSit thingies. Yeah? Color is normally implemented using WotSits or marks or whatever kind of stuff. And this is actually an interfering thing. So there are directives in this stream saying, okay, here we start a caller, there we finish a caller. Now this is different from fonts. For instance, if you copy a box, the surrounding font definitions is applied to that box. So it's those are slightly different mechanisms. Fonts is a rather unique mechanism in that sense. So at some point we thought, well, it would be handy to have something more generic than fonts, and then we came up with attributes. They can each node basically can have an attribute, and there can be basically an enormous amount of attributes and an enormous amount of values of attributes, and they carry or are carried along with these nodes, with these, for instance, glyphs or whatever, and they are behaving like fonts. So when this was very promising, I started, well, let's first start with redoing the caller mechanism, and because it's a nice candidate for that, and that works quite well because you get rid of the interference things. On the other hand, you must realize that this introduces an incompatibility, because as I told you, if you have something like a special or whatever saying go red, you copy a box, then the box content is really done red. But if you talk about attributes just as like fonts, it's basically frozen. Yeah? It won't get red because, well, this attribute telling that the stuff should be red is not applied to that. In practice, this is not a problem, but this is one of the things where a macro package writer might have to redo some of the things that used to be done, especially things that were done out of efficiency. Like I have a box, I copy it 10 times, or I reuse it later on. Well, maybe it's better now to regenerate that content. But this is really, I think, the only functional extension to tech attributes, and it's really handy. I use it all over the place. For instance, one of the things that has been bothering me, and seems not only me, for a long while, is vertical spacing, of course. And the only nice thing about XMLFO is that they have a rather advanced vertical spacing model combined with penalties and weighted spacing and things like that. So I had a model for this laying around already for a long time, and I've now on and off been start playing with this. But this is again one of the areas where, just like in the paragraph builder, the hyphenation, kerning, ligature building was really split. We are now in the process of splitting off all the other things in tech into clearly separated stages, because if you want to implement this kind of stuff, well, something is added to the vertical list. Well, what happens exactly? Maybe tech at the same time has some secret pointer pointing to something, and you change something, and the whole thing, you suddenly end up in a loop. That's the kind of nasty stuff we have now, and we are now in the stage that we are going to do that kind of stuff. This is, again, something that may have quite some impact, because it might give better output, but incompatible with the old stuff. Just to give some examples of where context underwent some fundamental changes, or not so much changes but extensions. Take, for instance, handling XML. In traditional tech, you can only handle XML basically by making characters active and treating it as a stream. One of the first things that I implemented in Lua, just for fun as an exercise, is an XML parser. And I found that it was so fast that I said, I have to do something with this. And now in Mark 4 we have a tree-based XML access. So I also added things like path searching in the tree, so I can really load a document and access each element in such a tree, do things with it, reshuffle it, manipulate it, and say, for instance, the table of contents now becomes something like, give me all the titles under the section element, things like that. The interesting thing of this is, and I can't show it because I have no running machine here, this is something where that has some mind-boggling aspects in it, because what happens there? Imagine you have this XML tree, and at some point you say, okay, now I trigger off basically flushing this whole thing. What we do is we associate actions with elements. And an action can be that something is printed to tag, which itself can trigger an action, like filter this and that from the tree. So what you basically get is one big, because Lua, the Lua command is completely expandable, what you basically get is one really big expansion going on there, calling tech, basically going back to tech, calling Lua, piping back to tech, calling Lua again, and then sometimes you have this situation, well, what's actually going on there? You can really interesting side effects. But sometimes you get accustomed to that. And this is, for me personally, one of the reasons why I can spend time on Lua there, because this is the kind of stuff that we can use actually in projects. So I gain back some time there that I can then waste on Lua there. So one of the things that has been re-implemented using this trickery is MarsML. We have MarsML 3 support, or at least we are working on it, and it is a way cleaner solution than we had. Image library was another important thing where we really kicked out lots of code from the context kernel and replaced it by image library code. Not so much in this case is scaling and all that kind of stuff, because we have rather advanced scaling models, but things like searching files, checking if file names are correct, yeah, cleaning up all kind of mess, that's way more easy to do in Lua, plus managing resources. On my agenda is currently a complete re-implementation of everything that deals with sectioning, numbering and lists. We already carry around the what we call multipass data, the stuff that goes into auxiliary files. Basically, there's one auxiliary file in context. Everything is kept in Lua tables, and then we can carry around a bit more information, and it's faster and things like that. And this is again one of the things where you really replaced lots of code, traditional code, which has been implemented in, well, Frank mentioned it long ago, you have to be really resourceful with that, has been re-implemented in ways that you sometimes think, yeah, I know it works and it does something, but what is it doing? Yeah, because, well, you build upon build upon build upon stuff. That also means that it's quite a job to rewrite this kind of stuff in such a way that it's still compatible. But at the same time, it becomes way more powerful. I'm also replacing, and that's actually starting now, and so we are now a few years down the road, and only now I start doing the nice thing, replacing the typographically related things that have been bothering me for long. If we have time, I can give a short example of that later on. So let's summarize what Lua means for the macro package writer, because that's what I'm basically talking about. Well, you can just use Lua as a language that can do some calculations for you. Hey, you want the number P in your document, and you can use Lua to print P in your document, or the value of square root or whatever. That's actually, I think, what most users will. The users will use Lua, the Lua stuff in LuaTeX that way. You can get a bit information about what Tef is doing, registers, things like that, and act upon that. I can imagine that Lua, that users still use some of that stuff. They use Lua counters and no Tef counters for doing kind of the certain things.
When you say Tef, you mean your typesetting engine and not Boltman's program?
Yes. I leave that open. You can pass data to Lua. So as an example is this XML stuff. You just pipe stuff to tech that you have manipulated before. And manipulating is more easy in Lua. Another good example is that your comma separated list. Yeah, that was one of the first things I think context users start asking. Oh, can we now have finally good, trustworthy comma separated list? Where you always have these problems with nested quoting and things like that. And it's easy to parse in Lua, pipe it to Tef, and do something with it. You can replace components. That's what I was telling about, the whole file searching, opening, reading, or everything related to file, even logging. So we always re-implemented the logging stuff. It means that you can, if you set a switch You won't get a tech error message. You will get an HTML page popped up showing you the message and the complete environment about where things happen. Things like that. Or your whole log, there's another switch that can say, I want the whole log in a well-formatted XML file so that you can really parse it and do things like that. So that's also done. More fundamental changes, as I mentioned, were the font changes. So that's then it really gets visible that Lua is being used. I can skip this one, but the whole bidirectional thing and complex open type stuff. One of the driving forces behind the LuaTech project is the OrientalTech project. Actually, the most demanding users are those who want to do Arabic typesetting, because I think then more or less all elements come together, also the directional stuff. So quite some time goes into that. Next step is attributes, as I mentioned. We implement things like color, but you can use attributes for basically anything. Replacing type, really components of the tech system itself, is just another step further, and that's the stage we were adding now.
Do you need a tech extension?
Just be quiet, let him finish, please.
Nobody else is harassing me about that issue. Just think, no, I think if Don Knut would be in this room, he would not be harassing about that kind of thing. You can, and that's something that I think then we are 3 or 4 years down the road, when we really start adding stuff to the core engine, like dealing with multi-column stuff, etc., etc. It also takes some kind of time to get into the thinking of what you can do. It could be that a year from now I can completely different things that I haven't thought about today of doing. Okay, so this is more or less a summary of the current state of what I do with that kind of thing. Just to give you an idea, I don't have my machine, but let me show you. So this is my directory of showing how many Lua files I have. That's some 4 megabytes of code, yeah? Okay, cheating a bit because there is the big character data definition table. You can imagine that loading all that kind of code at runtime is not really an option. This is why quite early in the project mechanism added actually a new type of register was added that could load and store Lua bytecode, which is then stored in the format. But even then, loading data, this is, you might think 2.7 meg is a big file. Well, the open type table of, say, error type of Safino is easily, in just plain Lua table format, 10 to 16 megabytes. In bytecode, only a few, and this is all kind of stuff that we catch. We keep a catch of things, and then loading becomes really fast. Anyhow, so this is the amount of currently amount of Lua code. So the specific Mark IV code, that's not that much, 272, and that replaces 498. So what you basically see is you get less tech code and more Lua code. And eventually, because you want to do more, you get more of both, I think. I want to show two files. Okay. Now, if you know context, and probably not that many people here know the really internal details, one of the features that has been around for a long time is that if you have one of the really core commands is the command that can frame something, because you can hook in all kinds of codes there. And one of the things that it can do is automatically calculate the width. So it can say, okay, there's some content, make this this let's say this area that we are dealing with as small as possible. And one way to implement that is by, well, you have something in a box and you start decomposing it. And then of course you have the problem of all the interfering stuff that's there, so that in the worst case it stops halfway and you cannot do it anymore. In practice it's not that bad, but it's not perfect. So one of the things I was thinking, wait a minute, I can do it in Lua. I can Lua have just at a certain moment, you can have, say, I have a box and I can look into the box what's there. So, wait a minute, I've opened the same file twice. So there was a command called reshape frame box, which was actually calling, I don't show the other code, calling some tech macros, which is to do it. And now this same macro is a call to Lua. So what you actually do is if you re-implement something in Lua, you put stuff in a Lua file and you just call a function. Where is it? Okay. This is an example. Yeah. We know that we pass the box number as an argument. And I want to know the minimum width, the possible minimum width of this box. These are just some speed ups. Yeah. Here I loop over all the horizontal list in this box and I check the width. And I do that by actually repacking the box to its natural size. That's what the node HPAC does. And in the end I know the minimum width I need to take. And in the next loop I'm going to set the width of all the already typeset H list in this thing. And as a bonus I can report back the number of lines and the last line length. The amount of code that does this is really small, as you can see, and it's way more readable and definitely more robust than the tech code where you start looking back basically in the reverse order and hope that nothing bad happens. This is what I mean with the more typographically oriented extensions, and well, unfortunately I didn't have that much time to spend time on this kind of stuff, but eventually we will be there. Imagine that you are going to do column balancing. And you can just do it by looking over a list, collecting data, trying to find the best point, not by doing taking this big thing and more or less trial and error on splitting it at places that work out well, but you can just do some analysis around and maybe even move stuff around. If you use attributes to tag something as being a graphic, you can basically say, okay, I can move the graphic around because I know it's a graphic. So, well, I hope this gives a bit of an idea about what we are heading to and what eventually will be, in this case, like a context mark 4, a mixture of tech and Lua things. And I think I can safely say that sometimes you hear people say, oh, this will become a mess and it doesn't change that aspect. Users can still mess around. You can look at the code, change something, and you may pray that it works well. In other places, that will not change. But what will change is that macro, the more complex macro package writing becomes more convenient. I hope at least.